If you're ready, ready, read. May I request Brother Jeremiah to please pray for the message. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. This morning, I am so grateful and so thankful to God for giving me another opportunity to preach the Word of God. And I will be on the topic of giving to the Lord. But this morning, I also, actually, to be honest, I'll be very honest with you. While doing this outline, I've been conversing with God. I am conversing with Him. Lord, not this message. It's not that I don't want to disobey God, but said, Lord, not this message. But the Lord kept on putting this in my heart. I am trying to go to another verses, chapter, and books from the Bible, and the Lord has kept on putting this in my heart. And by the grace of God, I was able to do this. I know God knows that. And a little bit on this topic in giving. But before I continue, I just want to give the title of this sermon: How God Wants Us to Give. How God Wants Us to Give. But before that, I just want to tell you something I just want to ask you something. What will be your feeling if I will say this to you? If I will give this something to you, imagine if I am going to give you something that is, let's say, a good thing, a precious thing, and think that you will be happy. Of course, when I give that to you, you'll be happy. But when the time that we had a misunderstanding, when we misunderstood each other, I told you, don't you know that I gave you something? Why are you fighting with me now? What will be the feeling? You will be hurt, right? You will be hurt. And you might say, as in, why did you give it to me in the first place? Right? Because if you will do that, even the things that I am, that's why I'm praying to God, Lord, if you will bless me without string attached to those people, they will just do this for the glory of God. Okay, so this morning I am going to share you from the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 9. I will be very particular in chapter verse 7. But here in chapter 8 and chapter 9, you will see it is about giving. Paul is teaching, and his letter to the Corinthians is about giving. Actually, in chapter 8, verse 1, Paul says here, "Moreover, brethren, we do you to wit the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. Why? How that in great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded unto the riches of their liberality. Out of nothing they went to give to the Lord. And this help will go to Jerusalem." Because that time they are in need, the brethren in Jerusalem. But here we're going to see why God loves a cheerful giver. Why God? When we already read that in the chapter 7, every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. Why does God loveth a cheerful giver? So that will be my sermon this morning. And I have 2 points this morning, or I have only 2 points this morning. There are two kinds of giving. And my point number one is the giving that God hates. Because there's a giving that God does not honor. He's not happy about it. You don't want to accept it. Just keep it for yourself. It's something like that. So here, giving that God hates. You know, something that we need to know, something, and that we must be reminded of, that we can never manipulate God. When we give to God, we can never manipulate Him, telling Him, God, I'm giving you this. Just like something, the one that I've told you, when you someone gave you, and when you fought, they will blame you. And they will tell you, don't you know that I have given you something? Right? They're trying to condemn you. But here, we can never manipulate God whenever we give to Him. Let us go to Psalms 50. I have read these verses before. And let us see this first. In Psalms 50, verses 7 until 13. God is talking to Israel. Psalms 50, verse 7 says, hear, O my people, the people of God, I will speak, O Israel, and I will testify against thee, I am God, even thy God. God says, telling the people of Israel that I am God, you must know who I am. Something, telling them something in that way. And says, even thy God. I am God, and I am your God. That is what he's telling them. In verse 8, I will not reprove thee for thy sacrifices or thy burnt offering to have been continually before me. He says here, I will not rebuke you. God saying, I will not rebuke you for giving something to me. I will let you continue doing this. In the first place, it's like saying, in the first place, you don't understand. You don't understand. Verse 9, I will take no bullock out of thy house, no he-goats out of thy folds. He will not accept this offering. Verse 10, for every beast of the forest is mine. The Lord says, and the cattle upon a thousand hills. I know all the fowls of the mountains, and the wild beasts of the field are mine. And then the Lord says, If I were hungry, I would not tell thee. For the world, listen to this, for the world is mine, and the fullness thereof. Psalms 24, verse 1. The Lord is the Lord, and the fullness thereof. Verse 13, will I eat the flesh of the bulls, or drink the blood of the goats? If you're going to look at it here, it says, these people are trying to give something to God, when it is not theirs. If you will go to verse 10, it says, verse 10, every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle upon the thousand hills are mine. I know all the fowls of the mountain. The Lord said, I know all of those fowls, those birds, and the wild beasts of the field are mine. So God saying, all of those things are mine, and now you are trying to give them back to me. But the problem is this. They are trying to give this to God. It's like they are braving God. They're trying to brave God. Later we're going to see that. God doesn't accept sacrifices in a sense of obligation or duty. We must know that. Here we can see that the people had the wrong concept in their giving, as if God had a need. The sacrifice was to cover the people's sin so God might have meaningful fellowship with them. They are giving so that God will have a meaningful fellowship with them. Our gifts or giving should be given with a heart of love. That's the way God will accept our giving. That is the only way that God will accept it, because of love. But here, if you're going to look at it, the Israelite people trying to give something to God. Where all of us, sometimes we are like this. We're trying to give something to God just to justify the things that we do. And just to ease the pain that we are suffering because we are not loving the Lord. That is the reason why. All of us, we are not perfect, and all of us, we have all our needs in our life. But God is telling us here, He will not take the offering that we are giving if it is not out of love. He will not accept it. the offering that we are giving to Him. So if you think you are giving millions, or I will impress God, or I will impress these people, you will never impress God, and you can never manipulate God. And sometimes you deprave yourself. Sometimes you are giving maybe $1, maybe $10, or maybe $20, and you are saying, Lord, I have a very small amount of money to give you, but I am giving you with my love. Don't deprave yourself. If you are doing it and giving it to the Lord with love, He will accept it. And that is the only way that can God accept our giving to Him. So here is something that we need to see, that we can never manipulate God. Whenever, because He's the one saying, all these things belongs to me. It's like He's saying, actually, if you will give me with love, actually I can give these all things to you, all these things to you. He can give it back to us. But the people here in Israel thinking that, oh, I will get the food of someone, or for example, the food of Milka, I'll get the food of Milka, she's so hungry, and then after I took it, and then I will give it to her. But Milka knew that I only took the food from her, and she will not be happy. Same thing with God. The things that we have now belongs to God. And I would like to always say this and emphasize this, that even the life that we have now doesn't belong to us. It was a borrowed life. It belongs to God. It doesn't belong to us. How this life belongs to God? Because He bought it. Actually, twice He bought it. Actually, before, He bought it from the hands of Satan, from the works of the devil, because of sin. He bought us. He died on the cross. He paid for the sin. He paid for our sin. He became, just like Brother Jeremiah said, He is our guarantee now, so that we can have all these things in our life. If you're going to look at it, people always say, God will provide, right? Abraham offered Isaac, and then when the Lord said, the angel of the Lord said, don't kill him, don't kill the boy, and then the Lord provided there a ram on a thicket, and the Bible says, God will provide, right? Something that we always claim. Always, oh, of course, God will provide. But remember the context. When God provided that time, where Abraham is and Isaac was, the thing that God provided, He provided something to offer back to God. And sometimes we say, God will provide. And when we say, God will provide, we'll take it to ourselves and not give it back to God. That is the context there. If you're going to study it, God will provide, He will provide something for us to offer back to Him, because we obeyed Him. So if we are disobeying God, how can He accept our giving in our life? So that was my first point, giving that God hates. My point number two is this: the giving that God loves. The giving that God loves. Here, God loves, here if you're going to look at it, God loves a cheerful giver, right? The Greek word for cheerful is hilarious. Hilarious. Hilarious means extremely happy. Extremely happy. If you're going to go to 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and 9, it is about giving. Paul is reminding the brethren at Corinth to complete their promise to the brethren in Jerusalem. By the way, I am only quote some verses from this chapter. I will not be going to tackle all the chapter, but I will be get some verses to get my point here. So here, chapter 8 and chapter 9, it is about giving, and Paul is now reminding the Corinthian church to complete or to do what they have promised to the brethren in Jerusalem. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 11, it says here, now therefore perform the doing of it, that as there was a readiness to will, so there may be a performance also, that out of what that which ye have. So here, Paul is telling them, now you fulfill your promise to them. Look at the Macedonian. They give out of their poverty. But you now, you were delayed for 1 year. Paul telling them, you were delayed for 1 year. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 2. For I know the forwardness of your mind, for which I boast of you to them of Macedonia, that Achaia was ready a year ago, and your zeal hath provoked many. And this, because of your promise, you know what? You were encouraged a lot. They were encouraged because of this. But the problem is that they were delayed for 1 year, and they've been expecting that gift to them because the brethren in Jerusalem are suffering. They are in need that time. When you give, it is according to what you have. It's like Paul saying this. Paul telling them, when you give, it is according to what you have. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 12, it says here, For if there be first a willing mind, it is accepted according to that a man hath, and not according to that he hath not. Okay, if you will give to the brethren, you will give what you have. You don't promise, you don't have. That's what Paul is saying. And in verse 24 of the same chapter, chapter 8, 2 Corinthians 8, 24 says here, wherefore shew ye to them and before the churches the proof of your love, and out of our boasting on your behalf. Now Paul is saying, telling them here, now you give them the proof that you have mentioned to them. This is the proof of your love. And Paul is saying also, actually we are boasting about this on your behalf. We are so happy because of you that you promised the brethren to give them something, because they are indeed. And that is Paul is what is telling them. Now let us go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 1. Don't worry, this is not a long message. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 1 says, for as touching the ministering of the saints, it is superfluous for me to write to you. What does Paul is saying? Paul is saying here, in Tagalog, superfluous, like, ito'y kalabisan pa para isulat ko pa ito para sa inyo. Because you already made a promise to them. In English, it is redundant for me to write this to you. Because Paul knew they already made a promise. They just needed to fulfill it. They just needed to show their love to them and to do what they have promised a year ago to the brethren in Jerusalem. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 2, for I know the forwardness of your mind, for which I boast of you to them of Macedonia, that Achaia was ready a year ago, and your zeal hath provoked very many. Very many means provoked very many. You encourage a lot of people because of this. But here, you will see in verse 2, for I know the forwardness, I know your willingness, I know you are willing to give this to the brethren. And if you are going to read chapter 8 and until chapter 9, you will see how these Corinthian people, they are really willing to give. And Paul, out of the things that this thing happened, Paul loved the Corinthian people. He loved them. And he is proud of them. So here it says, you have encouraged a lot. You have encouraged a lot of these brethren because of what you have promised to them. So here, let us go to verse 7, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. Here we're going to see how they should give to God. How they should give to God. Look at this. Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. How God wants us to give. How God wants us to give. When we give to him, here we will see in verse 7, Paul gave this, it says, every man according as he purposed in his heart. So here, this is how we give to God. When we give, it's either there are two meanings here, every man, every man. It says here, every man, it's either every man inside the church or every man that give. Okay? Every man here, it should be it probably every man or everyone inside the church or everyone that give it. When he gave, he says here, it should be everyone be giving or the one that giving as he purposed in his heart. When we give, let the Holy Spirit lead you. This is something that we need to be aware of. Something that we need to be sensitive of. Sometimes the Lord is telling us to give, but the problem, we keep on ignoring the Holy Spirit. Something that we think that, oh, in giving, I think it's not the Holy Spirit, it's only me. But do you know that even in our giving, the Holy Spirit will speak? The Holy Spirit will be the one to lead you. What will you give? How much will you give? Or what does what God want you to offer to Him? It is the Holy Spirit that speak in our hearts. Something that we need to know. Something, you know, a lot of preachers, even some pastors in the Philippines, they mentioned it, that one of the most neglected, one of the Trinity is the Holy Spirit. And we know that. Actually, sometimes we are one of them. That we neglect the Holy Spirit, especially when it comes to giving. Sometimes, God knows you don't have anything in your pocket. You have only this. But the Lord will still convict you, not grudgingly, to tell you to give this. I'm not telling that you will empty yourself and then you will be in hunger. No. What I'm trying to say is that the leading of the Holy Spirit is the one that we need whenever we give. We are not trying to impress God. Just like in Psalms 50, they are trying to impress God with their givings. And then the Lord said, it's mine, why are you giving it to me? So when we give, let the Holy Spirit, as we purpose it in His heart, means let the Holy Spirit lead you. Not grudgingly or of necessity. We should not give under pressure. Hindi tayo napipilitan, no strings attached. Something that we need to see. Our pastor, sometimes when our pastor preaches about the show, the pastor wants me to give again. No. Don't be under pressure. Be led by the Holy Spirit. Whenever, you know why you are getting hurt? When our pastor mentioned this thing, oh, the Lord is, pastor is trying to preach this because of me. No. He's being led by the Holy Spirit to help you, to help us. This is something that we need to know. He's telling us that when we give, we are not in a pressure that, my pastor got angry. Okay, let's go on that. Okay, you gave because you don't want your pastor to be angry, or our pastor, or anyone who preaches the word of God. But the problem, that offering will not be accepted by God. It is not done because of Him. It is not done out of love. So here, in Tagalog, napipilitan. Pipilitan lang tayo. Bakit mo inisip to? But later on, we're going to see, and I hope and I pray after this, we're going to see why we give to God. Why we give to God. For God loveth a cheerful giver. Let that sink in first. If we're going to look at it, for God loveth a cheerful giver, we can also say in this way, because God loveth a cheerful giver. Because God loveth a cheerful giver. Look at this. Notice this. God loveth a cheerful giver. Look at the word God. When Paul mentioned it, you know, when I'm studying this, I'm really blessed with this. And look at this. It says here, God, the last phrase of verse 7, God loveth a cheerful giver. And look at the word God. Why not the Lord loveth a cheerful giver? Well, it's the same, right? Yeah, it may be the same, yes. God or the Lord or the Holy Spirit, it's the same. They are one. And we know that. But here, there is something that God wants us to know. There is something that Lord wants to teach us here. When this verse was mentioned, God loveth. The Lord is teaching us something here through Paul. 2 Corinthians 9:15. Look, you go to the last verse of 2 Corinthians chapter 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 15, it says here, thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. It was mentioned again. It says here, thanks be to God, who loveth a cheerful giver for his unspeakable gift. What is that gift? Let me read these verses. It will not be a long message. But look at this. What is that unspeakable gift? John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave, that is the gift, his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This unspeakable gift gave us eternal life. He gave us eternal life. John 4 verse 10. John chapter 4 verse 10. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked him of him, and he would have given thee living water. It says here, if the Samaritan woman, if thou knewest the gift of God, do we know the gift of God? And that gift of God was given to us when we first got saved. It was given to us by the Lord. We have that gift. Romans 6:23, a famous verse, we know this. For the wages of sin is death. We know that. The payment of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The gift of God is eternal life only because of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the gift. That is the unspeakable gift for us to know. I know you know this, but I'm trying to just remind you. And in Romans chapter 8, verse 32, it says here, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? If God was able to give us his son, what else do we need that he will not give? And this is the unspeakable gift that is mentioned in verse 15. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that is not of yourselves. It is what? It is the gift of God. So here, if you're going to look at it, we are in a topic of giving. And in verse 15 of chapter 9 of 2 Corinthians, it says here, thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. We are here, if you're going to study it, it is about giving. But in the last verse of chapter 9, Paul mentioned that thanks unto God, that we need to give our thanks to God because he is the first one who gave us gift. And that gift is an unspeakable gift because that is the Lord Jesus Christ. And we know that. And now, let me ask you this. Why does God love a cheerful giver? Okay, we can give to God, right? We can give to God happy. We can give to God in a way that we are so in a good mood, in a way that we are so happy to do this for him. But it says here, the only one that will be loved by God is a cheerful giver. And my question is this, why does God love it, a cheerful giver? And why is it that when we give to God, he will accept it? Have you come to the point of that? That whenever we give to God, why are we giving to the Lord? Why are we giving this to him? What is our motive? Is there a motive? Is there a reason why we give to God? And if there is a reason why we give to God, what is that reason? Here Paul is emphasizing in giving, it is God who gave us gift. He's the first one who gave us gift. And that gift is unspeakable. Something you cannot measure, something that is awesome gift, something that we are not worthy to accept it. And now, Why does God loveth a cheerful giver? We can only give to God because of His Son. We can only give because of His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the only reason why God will accept our offering. Remember, if we think, let us go back to Psalms 50 first. Psalms 50, okay, sorry po, dito ko na lang babasaya. Oh, where's that? Okay. Verse 8, it says here, I will not reprove thee for thy sacrifice, for thy burnt offerings to have been continually before me. This is the thing that you are doing continuously. But I will not take your bullock out of thy house. I will not accept it. For no he goats or out of thy folds, for every beast of the field is mine, and the cattle upon the thousand hills. I know all the fowls of the mountains and the wild beasts of the field. Look at this. The Lord did not accept that, though these people are giving to the Lord. And the only thing that God will accept our giving to Him, or God will only accept our giving to Him because of His Son. And now, why He loveth a cheerful giver, before I end. Why God loveth a cheerful giver? This is the answer. When we give because of His Son, He loveth our giving. You know why God loving our gift to Him? Because we are saying, Lord, I am giving this to You because of Your Son, not because of me. Because in me, the Lord just belongs to Him. I have nothing in me to give You. But because of Your Son, I am giving it back to You with love. And the Bible said, God loveth a cheerful giver. That is the only way that God will love the one who gives to Him. When we give because of our Lord Jesus Christ. And something that we need to know, and I hope we will be reminded of this. Maybe the first months, years of our life, maybe it is not in that thinking. I'm only saying this. But at least now, when we know, when we give to God, make sure so that it will not be in vain. Give because of the Son of God. Because that is the only access that God will accept our offering, because we have the Son, His Son. And because of His Son, we are giving it back to Him. And because of that, God loveth a cheerful giver. Let us all stand up and let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we are so grateful.